Stiff bikes are more efficient, aren't they? I mean, frame flex robs us of power. So a stiffer bike, therefore, will transfer more of our energy into the drivetrain. That is a statement that many of us take as fact. And with good reason, because pro cyclists want stiffer bikes, and they go pretty fast. And bike manufacturers sell us stiff bikes, because by and large, that's what we ask for. And probably because bike testers praise stiff bikes to the rafters. But is it actually true? Well, we need to go on a bit of a mission. Anyone with a basic grasp of physics knows that the first law of thermodynamics states that energy can be neither created nor destroyed, just transferred from one form into another. And when you think about that in the context of frame flex, it can kind of leave you scratching your head a bit. Energy could be transferred into heat, but I can't imagine a rider, even of the caliber of Tony Martin, really generating anything meaningful through frame flex. Noise could be another one, but while there are lots of bits of your bike that do make noise, frames don't tend to, not until they're about to die anyway. So the question is then, if frame flex really does transfer energy away from your drivetrain, where then does it go? Maybe it's right back into it. We come down to the Bicycle Academy, which is a frame building school based down in Frome, just down the road from the GCN HQ, because Tom Sturdy, who's the engineer that looked after the design process of the GCN handbuilt bike, is the head of education here, and he has long been thinking about this frame flex conundrum, and he's just in there. Now, Tom and I were out on a ride just after Christmas. We were discussing this problem, and you said that you had a very simple way to illustrate just how a flexi frame might deliver that energy straight back into the drivetrain. So can you tell us what we're going to do today?
Okay, so we've got a frame here that's moderately flexible, and we've mounted it into a turbo trainer just to hold the bike in one place. We've got it so that the rear wheel can spin, and what we're going to do is we're going to flex the frame, so use some energy to flex the frame in a way that we can pause it and talk about it at different points and see what happens when we release it.
Cool. Right then, let's go for it.
So what we've got is this very solid block here that's definitely not going anywhere.
I can barely move it.
And we're going to move the pedal just so that it's resting a few millimeters, a centimeter above that block.
Okay.
At this point, what we're going to do is we're going to get Si to get on the bike and hold the rear brake so that the wheel cannot rotate. And we're going to load that pedal, which is going to flex the frame, but not spin the rear wheel because of the brake.
All right, shall I jump on?
So the pedal is now resting against this solid block.
Yeah. So the back wheel hasn't moved.
The back wheel hasn't rotated because you've got the back brake on.
So therefore the frame
So has what has happened is you've put energy into the frame which has flexed it and lowered the pedal to touch that block.
Quite a lot of energy as well.
So quite a huge amount of
energy. There's a lot of power going through that.
Yeah.
Okay. And so I literally just release the back brake.
That's right. So just release the rear brake.
Okay. You ready for this? 3, 2, 1. Whoa!
And so we can see that the rear wheel has spun as that energy has been released back into.
Well, not just spun, that was quite a significant spin, wasn't it?
If you want, we can go over to the whiteboard and draw a couple of illustrations to work out exactly what's going on.
I'd love it, a bit of whiteboard action. Right, let's do it. So I'm kind of struggling to get my head around this, okay? So I've seen the back wheel suddenly spin into life. But I can't quite work out how flex in a frame has actually contributed to that. So talk us through what you think's happening.
So before we start thinking about the flex, let's have a look at what's going on. Here is a seat tube viewed from the back, joining onto a bottom bracket shell. So we're going to be standing on a pedal that's out here. What happens when this tube is loaded is that it actually flexes around the center line of the tube. The important thing to notice is that the height of the bottom bracket changes on the side of the bike that's been loaded. And what's important about that is the difference in height between the loaded side of the bottom bracket.
Okay.
Okay. And what that means from a side-on view is that you have the bottom bracket center there and your pedal, which is somewhere out here.
Okay.
When you stand on the pedal, lowers. So the bottom bracket lowers, as we've just seen, and the pedal lowers, as we saw, to rest on that block. When you then release the energy and allow the frame to flex back, there's the bottom bracket flexes back to the starting point and so rises up. The pedal doesn't move because it's on the block, and so what you get is a clockwise rotation of the chain set, which spins, turns the chain and spins the rear wheel.
Theoretically, then, that is how the energy is getting from your flexi frame back into the drivetrain. And also, you then think, well, if that's happening out on the road, and I suppose that is a big if, it would be happening when you start to unweight or put less force through the pedal, which would therefore be, you know, at that point in the pedal stroke, where actually having some extra contribution would come in handy, be of benefit.
Yeah, absolutely. This illustration isn't going to be exactly how it happens on the road, because we've exaggerated quite a few things, but that's where the principle would come in, that as you start to put less and less force through the pedal, the frame will flex back, and it's at that point that you get that useful clockwise rotation of the cranks, which can make a difference to what the rider's feeling.
Yeah, so as an empirical experiment, we're not suggesting how much it contributes back, but as an illustration, it does show that something is happening, I guess, when you flex a frame and then it's contributing back. In terms of possible holes in the illustration, I mean, where might that energy be stored if it's not coming from the frame flex? I mean, realistically, would there be some torsion in the hub, or by sort of putting the drivetrain under load, would that contribute, you think?
I think that there's going to be an element of all of that. There's no way of us absolutely isolating the frame alone. There's going to be a bit of twist and flex in every single part of the chain. And so that's why it's difficult to say exactly how much the influence that might have on the road.
Okay, with that in mind, I have brought the stiffest bike that I have at my disposal, which is my Orbea Orca Aero. It's unbelievably fast. Can we stick that on the trainer and see what happens?
Absolutely, yeah.
All right, see what happens. Okay, I'm loading up.
Right, you ready?
3, 2, 1.
So I think what's happening here is a good illustration that because it's such a stiff frame, you're actually having to put a lot of energy into it to get the frame to flex enough for the pedal to be on the block. So there is a lot of energy stored in it because you've had to put a lot in to flex the super stiff frame.
So theoretically then, there could be no difference at all to your performance out on the road from the stiffness of a frame, as long as it's within certain limits, because if it's a stiff frame, it's not going to flex that much, and so all your force will be going into the drivetrain. But if it does flex a little bit, it's going to be giving it back, whereas if it flexes more, it will then be giving more back.
Yes, potentially, and that's where there's going to be a big grey area as to where the actual benefits lie. I guess the key is that perhaps it's not as important as people once assumed.
Well, what do you think about that? I'm hoping this is going to spark loads of debate down in the comments section, so do make sure you get involved. Is Tom's experiment correct? Could that movement of the rear wheel come from something else? And in fact, what do you think about the whole principle of stiff frames going faster? For me, I just wonder whether frame flex is going to be like the new tire pressure. So you go back 10 years and we all knew, didn't we? We just knew that harder tires rolled faster, and we could feel it as well. Except that now we know that actually lower pressures can roll faster, because whilst you might get more hysteretic loss, you get less suspension loss, and so it is more efficient. So maybe frame flex is the same thing. Stiff frames feel faster, except actually maybe they're not. Get involved in the comments section. And if you want to watch another video on actually the subject of tires and hysteretic loss and suspension loss, the truth about wider tires and wider rims, then why not click just over there? It's another good in-depth piece.